So the printing process, IC, UC, so that's instant command, unified command, objective meeting, is what are those agency requirements? What did we just get briefed from the senior leadership? What are the current objectives? So is there any current objectives that they're doing out in the field that we need to incorporate, that we need to include? Are there any restrictions, time, resources, whatever the other might be? Is the incident stable? Is it increasing in size? Are we slowly getting control of the situation and it's decreasing? Keep it in mind that a lot of incidents sometimes just kind of explode into a different situation. So we need to be ready with our planning to kind of look at the different aspects of where we're going to go. Are there any safety issues that we need to consider? Are there any environmental issues? So here's our common operating picture for the current situation. Here's our map, and they've established an 800-foot cordon. Our objectives at this point is mission assurance, is to keep the other businesses and stuff in the area going, protect lives, that's kind of one of those that's always there, and protect resources. So if we can stop other resources from being engulfed in this situation, then we're going to do so. So the next step of the process is the strategies meeting. What are some key strategies to employ to accomplish each of those three main objectives? So just coming out of the meeting, here's our strategies on our common operating picture. So we can see that we want to keep the main roads open. That's probably something that was given by the senior leadership. We want to shelter in place anybody that we cannot evacuate, that'll be in the hazard plume. Evacuate those that we can. Prevent the fire from spreading to adjacent buildings. So we have to lay down some sort of suppressant and contain any hazmat that is leaking from that area. So the next step in this planning process is the tactics meeting. So based on our current strategies, now we're going to look at exactly how are we going to accomplish each one of those strategies. Phone a friend. Ask a specialist. Hey, how do we do this? Okay. Never hurts to ask for help. There may be somebody that can find and see something that we don't. What do you need? Is there certain things that we need? And we do that resource typing to actually get those resources into play. And also through our mutual aid agreements and so forth. Safety officer. When they're looking at that, how do we keep safe? One, our first responders. Two, our witnesses. Three, our victims. Fourth is news media and the public. And also, what does the safety officer need? Are the individuals that are responding to the scene actually have the proper safety equipment that they need to be wearing? Do they have a proper PPE? Are they using the right filters? That type of thing the safety officer needs to make sure of. So, we have our tasks that are here. Providing a cordon, keep Long Point Road open, which is on the map over there as 1A. We can kind of see that. Conduct evacuation, prevent that fire from spreading, contain the hazmat, and also interview witnesses so that we know how this started. And that's something that we always need to consider in any type of an event is what is that investigation going to lead to? And what kind of forensic type evidence do we need to try and keep? Whether you're a first responder or you're in the operations center, that is vitally important to kind of keep in the back of your mind. So in our tactics meeting, can we do the task with what resources that we have? Do we need to call in mutual aid agreements? Do we need to call other areas? Or do we need to start having part of our Army responders start headed our way, such as the civil Civil defense teams. So at the planning meeting, who does what? So we have the operations chief, who's kind of leading that meeting at that point, safety officer, the public affairs, logistics chief, and the finance chief. As we kind of discussed previously, finance chief is concerned about where is this money and stuff coming from. The logistics chief is worried about where are we moving stuff from and to. And our public affairs officer is what kind of a public image are we trying to display, what type of information needs to get put out, not only externally, but possibly also internally. Our safety officer is looking at that scene, making sure the safety of all the individuals involved, everybody from the responders to everybody at the scene. So, here is, as we kind of expanded this out from our task, from our meeting, the police department is providing that cordon. They currently have people that are out on that location. And then the police is also going to keep Long Point Road open, so that's going to be our established kind of entry control point. And we have a CERT team that actually showed up. So with that CERT team, they're going to be doing the evacuation, and they'll be getting their orders from another spot. And then fire command is preventing that fire from spreading. And we're giving them that generic type task. We're not telling them exactly how to completely accomplish it, because that's their job. That's what they do. So the hazmat team is going to be containing that hazard. And intel section, or our criminal intelligence, is going to be doing the witness interviews. So planning process, course of action approval. Planning chief, agencies require, do we meet the agency requirements? Did we gameplay any developed course of actions? This is the same thing as that rock drill that we discussed previously. So we basically practice it on the table or in front of other people and say, is this what we're looking at? And now we can get that input of, yeah, okay, so if you're doing that, then I can come in from this way. Or if you use this road, then I can use this road. So you can kind of gameplay and kind of look at the different situation, and that way you also know who's on your left, who's on your right, so that you're all part of that teamwork. What are the recommended course of actions that you need to provide to that incident commander so that they can approve those and we can move forward with the next step, which is the incident action approval. So our common operating picture now looks very close to the same. If you'll notice over there on the map, we now have established the ICP, and we're actually placed right there next to the entry control point. We've also identified where the hydrants are. We've our CCP, which is our casualty collection point, and the SA, which is our staging area, is just outside of our cordon along the Long Valley Road. And our decon station, which is just inside of our ECP, so therefore we can decon our first responders before they get out of the cordon. So in the IAP approval, some things that we need to ask ourselves is, did we address the agency requirements? Did we address the public information, not only externally, but also internally? Did we address safety requirements? Did we address who is doing what? Did we leave any portion of that out of play? And that's that question and answer piece to make sure that everybody knows, or the rock drill to make sure that everybody knows what's going on. Did we address a relief process? Currently, we've had individuals out on the field for several hours. We need to address how do we relieve them in place, provide them respite, and then put new people out there. Especially if it's kind of a hot situation, there's certain limitations when you're wearing hazardous materials gear or when temperatures are above a certain level, you need to take those things into consideration. Location of the casualty collection point, what are they required to do? Does the ambulances know where those are at? Does the helicopters know where those casualty collection points are? Do they have their landing zone identified? Location of the decontamination point. Also something too to consider with that decontamination point is basically where are we putting the contaminated suits and everything else? We can't just throw them off to the side, you know. So is there a dumpster, is there something that we can use, or a truck bed or something to actually put all that contamination? I understand this list isn't all inclusive. It's dependent upon the situation, it's dependent upon the event, but the same thing can happen throughout any type of thing that's going on. Next. So now we're gonna do the operational period briefing. So this is the actual piece where the incident commander stands up and he says, welcome everybody. We're gonna do our operational briefing at this time. And I can see that everybody's all present here today. We're gonna go over our objectives, our strategies, and our tactics. Each of you have a particular assignment today to accomplish this goal. We currently have people that are out on scene, so we need to make this kind of quick. But if you do have any questions, please make sure that you ask those. We're going to cover our safety information, weather, communications, what are our radio channels, what are our phone numbers for relief, the call back to the dispatch center. Are there any particular locations that are out on the map that you need to be aware of? And then also, if there's emergency information, if we call Lifesaver, which is our keyword, then everybody knows that somebody's in danger and we need to focus in on that so that we can keep our first responders safe and secure. So here we have our warehouse fire. We're currently having an evacuation zone that's here. The CERT team is actually conducting that evacuation. You've got that, okay? So our police department providing the cordon, is there any additional resources that you need? Okay. So also keeping Long Point Road open. Understand that we cannot park any emergency equipment along Long Point Road. It's been very specifically told by our agency administrators, our senior executive leaders, that we're coming up upon the 5 o'clock traffic. If we block that, we're gonna have more situation than we're going to currently have right now. So we cannot block that road at this time. So fire command, you've got the plan. You figured out how to basically look at and do preventing that fire from spreading. Okay. Hazmat team, is there anything else that you guys need when we go out on scene, when you're leaving those guys in place? Any more socks or anything that you guys need? Okay, so not at this time. And criminal intelligence, you've got the list of individuals. The police already did that and they moved them over to the staging area. At this time, is there any question? Okay. So this is how that kind of a quick rendition of an operations brief will give out. You'll reference the IAP, everybody will get handed a copy of that incident action plan. So if they have anything that they need to refer back to, or if you talked really quick during a particular channel or something, they can always look back and see where that's at. So the last step that's here is supervise and refine. This is where you empower those supervisors and leaders that are out in the field to actually do their job. So while they're out in the field, if they need to adjust left and right, one thing is communicate with the incident commander, but in the other aspect is make those adjustments, especially when you're dealing with mission assurance, safety of the personnel, or you're protecting those resources. So some of the questions, are there changing requirements? Is there something drastic that incident commander needs to know? Is the plan working? Do we need to adjust? Not only do we need to adjust now, But as the Emergency Operations Center, anticipate what do we need to adjust for the next operational period if we go into another operational period. And that's what we do during that supervise and refine. Now, this is when the operational period officially begins, is when everybody's out on the field, everybody's been relieved, that other group goes in for respite, and then we're going to start this process over again for the next operational period. So about an hour or so before that relief, we'll be going through this and say, okay, where are we at? And we're going to go right around the bend. So we have an IAP for that operational period, issue it, give the briefing, so everybody knows what they need to do, and they go out and relieve the next crew. So forms and documents, kind of a quick overview, is that incident action plan that's there. We have a cover sheet. We have the objective, which is the 202 form. We have the ICS 203, which is the assignment list. We have the 204, which is individual team type assignments. 205, which is the incident communications plan. 206, which is our medical plan. And understand this isn't all inclusive. You can also include other things such as the safety messages, maps, weather forecasts, other things that seem imperative to what you're doing. The same type of process, same type of thing that you would issue out as an operations order is all-inclusive within an incident action plan. And we're going to touch on that during a different training series as to how to use each one of these forms. So, additional supporting documents, those safety messages, you know, making sure that people wearing steel-toe boots, they got the goggles on. You know, if it's a winter time and they got spikies on, what are those safety messages that need to be included? If there's a particular filter that needs to be used for that type of chemical, that needs to be included in a safety message. So detailed weather forecasts are some of those things that, you know, not only what are the current conditions, how do they get to the weather stations that are within that local area, and also what is that 3-day, 7-day forecast? Because if we have a decontamination event that's going on, then where is that contamination flowing to? And if we're getting rain, is that going to affect our operations? Is it going to change what we're going to do? So a traffic plan might be something that we did for that road to kind of include there to say how we're going to make sure that we don't block that road off. So it may include something like a parking area or so forth for everybody that's coming in. Other important information that you need to include, you know. So those are some considerations that you need to make for that incident action plan. Okay. So some of the other types of meetings which may be included, you may have like sidebars off of the main process, is strategy meetings. It may be something that you have to discuss more in depth because it may be more of a complex problem. Team meetings. As they go off, they may have particular team meetings. You know, the leader comes in and says, this is what we need to do. And in that team meeting, they double check the trucks, they double check their equipment, and that's what they do. And then they move out. So team closeout, something I really like to focus in is that you always focus on your demobilization when you are initiating a team mobilization. When somebody starts, you always think of how you're going to actually turn them back home. So those team closeouts are very important. They include after action reports, kind of what did we do good, what did we do bad, what do we need to have on the truck for next time, and how do we improve so that maybe I don't risk somebody else's life or property or whatever else, and how do we work on that as a team. Special planning meetings, these would be more for events. So how do we include them in there? And maybe it's a particular focus, maybe you've got a carousel, maybe you've got some safety related equipment or safety things such as a bounce house or something for an event that you're considering. And they need to do a planning meeting just for that type of stuff. You know, if you got children related, I would suggest using a special planning meeting to just address them or if you have any additional type of hazards that are going on. Transition meetings, basically that's kind of the sidebar type thing that we're doing out in the, you know, out of the meeting, transitional between each one of those types. So, today we've just went over, identify the importance of planning for incidents and events, explain the differences between planning for incidents and events, the differences of troop leading procedures and the ICP process, explain the criteria for determining when the incident action plan should be prepared in writing, and we also covered the review of the planning pre-process. So some of the things to consider is this all comes out of the National Incident Management System. Some other things that you may want to use is the Emergency Response Guide. A lot of the stuff that came out of there was also out of the Staff Officer's Handbook. And you can also use some things just like this for Incident Command System. Thank you. I hope you learned a few things today that can improve your activities. And for the next training series, I am Quentin Graham, Emergency Manager for Sierra Army Depot. Have a great day.